Hey folks, this is Custom Chess for Roma Custom Bike, and after a great rejuvenating vacation full of awesome news that I'll tell you about later, I'm back with the third episode of the series about the Triumph Speed triple based custom bike. In the first episode of this series, we took care of the demolition and the rebuild of the tail end out of sheet metal. In the second episode, we have looked at how to design and build some new parts for this project using CAD software and a CNC machine. In this two parts episode, the third of the series, we'll take a look at the Arduino based electronics that we'll be using to power the new accessories. And last, but definitely not least, in the fourth episode, we'll take care of the paint job, assembly, and unveiling the bike to the owner. So be sure to stay tuned, subscribe to the channel, and follow the links in the description to find all the episodes of this series. In the last episode, we designed and built some new accessories for the project, documenting from the creative process all the way to the final touch-ups. It's now time to breathe some life into them with some electronics. I think that to be contemporary in the custom bike scene, we need to separate the looks from the function. Even people like me that appreciate the old school and retro look still expect the project to function with 21st century technology. In this two-part episode, I'll try to do an overview of the main components in the project and to analyze the challenges we had to overcome to reach the final goal. So, let's start by introducing the real star of the show, the Arduino. It's a programmable microprocessor, made in Italy, that has become the worldwide standard for prototyping. In essence, it's a board that allows for sensors, inputs, and outputs management. If you don't know it, I suggest you Google the Arduino board to find out more, cause it's really, really cool. Since the project requires a bit of programming, I immediately called on my friend Sergio.
Ero tranquillamente al lavoro quando una brutta persona, Chez, mi ha chiamato e mi ha detto avrei bisogno di fare una cosina, ma una sciocchezzina, una cosa che fai come niente. E ho avuto la malsana idea di dirgli di sì.
He's right, he actually did take quite a bit longer than expected.
Chez mi ha chiesto un'accensione sequenziale di più lucette LED in maniera che venisse un effetto tipo supercar, per capirci.
Some people might find it cheesy, but I used to love the Knight Rider, and I still do. But anyway, the objective is to manage a sequential light up of the LEDs by interpreting the signal from the existing turning light system, making our project totally plug and play.
Io avrei preferito cambiare direttamente la centralina e farne una nostra, sarebbe stato più semplice da gestire. Ma siccome non sappiamo che cosa succederà in futuro a questa moto, chi altri ci metterà a mani, volevamo qualche cosa da poter staccare e riattaccare a piacimento.
So, among all the different models, I picked the nano version, that at the price of 9 euros is perfect for experimenting. I started by figuring out the logic and the design of the circuitry. In short, every single output pin of the Arduino feeds a transistor and a series of resistors to get the right tension and amperage to pilot the high luminosity LED light. Using a circuit designing software, I solved the routing of the connecting tracks so that I could prototype the board. While Sergio keeps coding away at all the different software issues, I kept busy by designing all the other circuits we'll be needing to power up all the different parts. Among them, the circuitry that manages the luminosity of the tail light. High for the stop light and low for the rest of the time. Last but not least, I finish up the board we designed in the last episode, shaped specifically to position all the single LED lights in the right place in the tail light. Meanwhile, Sergio is done with the first working code and is testing it out on a breadboard. The coding not only is in charge of interpreting the signals coming from the turn signal lines, but he also manages the timing for the power up and down of each LED.
Le frecce, facendo questo on-off, dovevano essere interpretate, perché io dovevo capire quando doveva essere accesa la freccia e nel momento in cui la centralina vera mi diceva che dovevano essere spente, in realtà io dovevo mantenere il segnale e poi spegnerle quando effettivamente non mi arrivava più segnale dalle frecce, che poteva voler dire aspettare qualche millisecondo.
And here is where we had the first trouble. The concept is very easy to explain, but it's hard to implement and it requires a lot of attention to details. I'll let Sergio figure the code out while I start carving the boards with the CNC machine out of some blank copper board. This is an excellent way to do prototypes, although the resulting board are a bit bigger than the printed type. These are the ones onto which we'll install the LEDs. The problem is that you want to carve deep enough to sever the copper layer, but the deeper you go, the thicker the line gets. So we have to find the perfect compromise. Coming up next is the taillight intensity regulator board. We tested the concept on another breadboard. The signal coming from the brake pedal goes through a regulator that changes the voltage on the anode of the LEDs, consequently changing the light intensity. Once we were sure it would work, I proceeded with creating the prototype board. Now it's time to tackle the control board. As you can see from the CAD design, it doesn't really look like a traditional board. This version has been optimized to reduce machining time and maximize track width. After all the brainstorming, analyzing, and prototyping, it's now time to verify if all this planning will actually work in real life. In the meantime, we start to develop a profound respect for every little thing we buy for our bikes, aren't we? I start by assembling the boards that will be mounted in the front turn signal pieces. Here, the space is very tight, and this space restriction has forced me to implement a bunch of wire bridges to complete the various routings. After each connection, I like to verify with the testing that everything is correct. After all, these parts, although they're prototypes, have to work for a very long time. Next in line is the installation of the LED lights, and the positioning, just like for the tail assembly, is crucial. Each LED has to fit in a hole in the piece, so during the designing phase, I paid particular attention at how I would actually install each and every one of them. I decided to push them all the way into the hole until the back of the LED would touch the board, so they would all have the same height and inclination. This board also will host marker lights, their white LEDs. With a brief test, I make sure that both the white and the yellow lights are working properly. Also, the side plates have space issues. Now that I'm done, I came to the conclusion that next time I'll make these parts out of thicker stock aluminum and make my life quite a bit easier. After all, that's why we do prototypes, to work out all the kinks. One more test and it looks like we're on the right path. No shorts with the aluminum structure and each light is turning on. Yeah, let's keep going this way. Coming up next is the circuitry I've designed for the taillight and stoplight. It works with a relay that, driven by a signal coming from the brake pedal, changes the value of the resistors connected to the adjustment pin of a voltage regulator. Again, I don't want to get too technical, but I suggest you Google some of the components I'm bringing up and expand your knowledge on them, because I'm pretty sure that sooner or later they will come in pretty handy. Positioning the LEDs on the taillight board is the most crucial task in this assembly. I've spoken about the design of this board in the previous episode, but to briefly recap, I've marked the board with the position of the two extremities of each LED, so I have a reference for the installation. Once the assembly of the LEDs is finished, it was time to hook up all the wires. As you can see, a lot of thought went into designing these pieces. Even the notches for the wires are rounded, so it keeps them from scraping against a hard corner. The top side is also assembled, and since it's an entire row of red LEDs, only two wires will be required. You might also notice that the carved spacers have been designed for keeping the boards, and consequently the LED lights, at the right distance between each other, as well as to leave enough space for the solders and the wires. It's now time to assemble the two halves and verify that all my calculations were correct. I just realized that I forgot to solder one LED light onto the board, but it's not a big deal. Now, what's important is to see if the brass plate will actually line up with all 26 LEDs. It looks like it does! Now, using a bench power supply, a quick test to verify that everything works. Most of the work we've done until now works off the main board, aka the main brain. It's a bit bigger than I expected, but I think that in version 2.0 we can reduce its size by a good 50%. Now, I would like to remind you that this channel exists because of you and your support. We're going to keep posting videos in English on this channel for the next few months, but we're also separating the Italian channel from the English one because YouTube is not yet really equipped to tailor to a multi-language channel such as ours. So, in the next few months, we'll be moving the English videos to the new channel called Custom Bike. I invite all of you guys to subscribe to it by clicking right here or in the link in the description. Please help us out by sharing the new channel and the videos on your social network. Thank you very much. As I've mentioned in the beginning of the show, I just came back from a month in the United States, where I had the pleasure to document a wonderful bike ride in Vermont, in the beautiful town of Burlington, right on the shore of Lake Champlain. It was quite hard to shoot while driving, but I assure you that the view is breathtaking. On the other side of the lake is where Canada begins, so we're plenty far north. You can see me wearing a leather jacket, although this footage was shot August 20. Contrary to my usual habits, I was actually driving under the speed limit, so very, very slow. But still, it was quite chilly up there, but fun nonetheless. I even managed to drop the kids off with some friends and go for a ride with my lovely wife. We haven't been able to ride together for a while, and now, thanks to our friend, we managed to carve out some time for ourselves. And that was just awesome. But that's not it. The most amazing thing happened during this trip. I was actually invited to hold the lecture on creativity and design in the North Brookfield High School, a town close by Boston, Massachusetts. You can imagine what an honor it was for me to be asked. Not only that, but I also was quite anxious. Although I'm used to speak in front of people, this was quite different. This high school has just opened their brand new CAD lab, and on all the computers they have installed Autocad Inventor, a nice design software available for free to all students. I've placed the link for this offer in the description. As you can see, the students have access to a complete lab, equipped with a top-of-the-line 3D printer and a nice workspace where they can assemble printed parts and manufacture handmade ones. The great thing about this program is that this course is for all students and not only for the ones in technical majors. So, the students finally arrived, and once seated, I finally did something I've always wanted to do.
My name is Custom Chess.
To write my name on the board, just like you see in every movie. So, I can take that one off my bucket list. The lecture went great, and I managed to engage the students for most of the 50 minutes classes. These were 13 to 16 year old young men and women, so as you can imagine, that was no easy task. But I gave it my best, and I gave my point of view about creativity in the mechanical field and digital design. Some of my friends commented that the world must be coming to an end if it's custom chess that is molding the minds of our future engineers. But you know what? Someone's got to do it, and probably I'm better than some. You know? Forget about it. This is it for this first part of this two-part episode. To go to part two, please click right here or on the link in the description. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel to receive notification of new published videos. Like and comment, and please share to help us grow. Now, I'd like to remind you to visit our website where you'll find all our new accessories and our t-shirt. Thank you very much for the support and for watching. I'm Custom Chess for Roma Custom Bike, and I'll see you in the next video. We'll be right back.